taking my sin, my cross, my shame. Rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all.
It's really a blessing to be able to see all of you again. A lot of faces that I recognize, and it's encouraging to be able to see all of you. After, I think the last time I was down here speaking in Lancaster was about 7 years ago. And so what a blessing to be back with all of you. I think it's appropriate after that beautiful song that we seek the Lord in prayer, amen? And so I'm going to invite all of us, in as much as possible, if we could please reverently kneel and invite the presence of the Holy Spirit. As we open up this evening's study together. Our gracious God and Father in heaven, what a blessing it is to be here this evening in the house of the Lord to fellowship with my brothers and sisters in Christ. So many faces that I remember from our friendships years ago, and many still in contact, and even new faces here as well. And it's such an encouragement to be able to fellowship with people that I desire to be in heaven with for eternity. We thank you that it's on this side of heaven that we develop the relationships that we can maintain on that sea of glass. We recognize that there's only one thing that we take to heaven. As the Apostle Paul said, that we brought nothing into this world, and it's sure that we can bring nothing out, except the Christ-like character and the relationships that we developed here on earth, the souls that we won to Christ, the influences of friendship and sweetness and holiness that we were able to impress upon one another on life's path below. And so, Lord, as we have come into the sacred hours of the Sabbath, I'm thankful that you brought me here safely. And we want to invite the presence once again of the Holy Spirit to tabernacle with us. As we fellowship this evening and looking at your word, we want to ask for discernment to help us to rightly divide the word of truth. And I pray that you please hide me in Christ and behind the cross, that I might not be seen. So please bless us in a very special way, and I pray that you would please be with this convocation weekend as well. May this be a high Sabbath, and may we receive the things that we need spiritually to encourage us, that we can continue to press forward toward the mark of the high calling of Christ. So bless us now. May your holy angels fill this place, and if anyone else is still coming, please bring them safely. We thank you for hearing these prayers in Jesus' holy name. Amen. I guess Perhaps a brief introduction will be in order. I think I recognize most of the faces in here. There's only maybe a couple that I've never seen before. Is that Brother Ramon back there? Oh, praise the Lord. Wow. Brother Arsenal. I remember back when you were still in the Navy. For those of you who don't know who I am, hello, sister, praise God. It's good to see all of you. For those of you who don't know who I am, my name is Pastor Richards, and I, many years ago, used to be the pastor of the Small Fellowship back when we met in a library in Palmdale, and it just started up here in Lancaster, and it's such a blessing to see so many friends from many years ago. So for me, this is really a blessing. I'm very encouraged to be here with all of you starting out this new year in 2016. I can't believe that I met most of you back in around 2001 or 2. It's about, 14 years ago it's been, right? So it's been a little bit of time. And I think what always surprises me the most is seeing the young people who get older. You know, in your mind, they never grow up. So next time you see them, they're all adults. And you still think they're 12, and now they're like 22 or 24 or whatever it is. And I think some of you have gotten the picture I sent out about my family. So we're starting to grow, be fruitful and multiply, trying to fill up that quiver. We just had the privilege last month of having our seventh child, our sixth surviving child, but our seventh little child. Hannah Ruth was born. I think I sent out a family photo to most of you. And so everyone's doing well. Just getting over colds. We're just so thankful to the Lord for the Lord's blessings this new year. And I'm really encouraged to be able to fellowship with all of you as well. Tonight, or this weekend, we're going to be going over a little mini-series. I'm not sure that's the appropriate word, a mini-series or not. I have a general theme. Tomorrow, for the main service, and I believe I'm speaking just for the main service. Is that correct, Pastor? And I'll be dealing with the sequence and sealing of the 144,000. I'd like to talk about that tomorrow. And so I'd like to tie that in a little bit tonight with dealing with the essential preparation of character needed to meet the Lord in peace. I'm going to invite us tonight, and I've just before we open up, it's about 7:30. How much time do I have tonight just so I can try to stay on the clock as much as possible? About 9 o'clock? Okay. I want to invite all of you to please turn with me in your Bibles as we get ready to study to the Gospel of Matthew. The Gospel of Matthew, chapter 13. Tonight, if you're going to be taking notes tonight, and I'm going to be trying to write some things up on the board so that all of you can follow along with me. If you're taking notes, you may want to try to jot down a title, and this is going to be speaking of the parable of the fig tree. Now, the parable of the fig tree is actually in Luke chapter 21. But before we go to Luke chapter 21, we're first of all going to preface this with something that Jesus says in Matthew chapter 13. Matthew chapter 13, and we're going to begin in verse 33. Matthew 13, beginning with verse 33. We'll be reading from verses 33 down through 35. And when you have that, if you can please just let me know by saying amen. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 13, beginning with verse 33, "Another parable spake he unto them. The kingdom of heaven is like unto leaven, which a woman took and hid it in three measures of meal, till the whole was leavened. And all these things," verse 34, and here's the point, "all these things spake Jesus unto the multitude in" what? "In parables, and without a parable spake he not unto them, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, I will open my mouth in parables, I will utter things which have been kept secret from the foundation of the world." Now, the reason I'm prefacing the study of the parable of the fig tree with that little quote is because we're told that Jesus spoke by parables to the people. Amen, correct? Now, how many of you, by a show of hands, are familiar with William Miller's rules of interpretation? How many of you are, I'm assuming that if you've been coming here for any length of time, you've been introduced to study principles, guidelines to how to rightly understand Bible prophecy, or how to rightly divide the word of truth, how to correctly understand Bible doctrine. So by a show of hands, once again, Miller's rules. Now in that, we're told that parables ought to be interpreted in the same way as visions. In other words, there's Bible symbolism that is used that Jesus in Jesus' language. Matter of fact, if you want to just very quickly turn with me to the Old Testament book of Hosea. And I want to encourage you tonight to make sure you have your Bible in your hand, have a pen and paper, because we're going to be going to and fro, back and forth in the scriptures tonight. Is that okay? So the book of Hosea, chapter 12, there's a scripture here that speaks about the fact that when God spoke to the prophets, he spoke by visions and he used symbols or similitudes. Hosea chapter 12 and verse 10, speaking of parables, speaking of visions, speaking of symbols. Hosea chapter 12, verse 10, are we all there together, friends? Amen? And the Bible says, I have also spoken by the prophets, and I have multiplied what? Visions, and used what else? Similitudes. Some versions have the word symbols there, by the ministry of the prophets. So when the Lord speaks, he speaks by similitudes or by symbols. And this is why we're told that Jesus himself, who's the author of Scripture through the Holy Spirit, he's the Word of God. So therefore, when he came in person or in the flesh, he continued that principle of speaking to people through symbols, through similitudes, or through parables. Are you all with me so far? Now, the point that I want to get to tonight, or the crux of the topic, the crux of the study, is actually coming from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 21. So Luke chapter 21, this is going to be the crux of our study tonight. As we turn there together, the parable of the fig tree, I'd like to discuss a little bit about the signs that we might know when the coming of the Lord draweth nigh. Now, how many here in this room have been Adventists for, let's just do a little scenario. How many here have been Adventists for the last 5 years? Okay. 10 years? 20 years? 30? I'm going on a limb here. Anybody here been Adventist for over 40 years? Okay, I'll stop there. I'm turning 40 this summer as well, so I'll make that the cutoff point. Now, for those of you who just raised your hand, being Adventist for 5 years, 10 years, 15, 20, 30, 40 years, some of the older saints have been Adventist for 50, 60 years, who've been in our churches. How many of you in your Adventist experience have heard the phrase that Jesus is coming again soon? Has everybody heard that? So if you've been an Adventist for even 6 months or 1 year or 5 or 10 or 20, 30, 40 years, 50, 60 years, you've heard over and over again that Jesus is coming again soon. Have you not? Matter of fact, our theme song in Adventism is what? Lift up the trumpet and loud let it ring. What? Jesus is coming. So this is our theme, isn't it? We call ourselves Seventh-day Adventists, Adventists recognizing that we're waiting for the second coming of Jesus. So the question is, why hasn't he come yet? And are there some certain, are there signs or things that have not been fulfilled yet why he hasn't come? I'm here tonight to talk about the nearness of his coming and to show biblical proof to show that we here are living in the last generation. I want to turn now to Luke chapter 21, if you're not there yet. And let's go ahead and begin looking at some of the signs of the last days. Now, in Luke chapter 21, as well as Matthew chapter 24, these are parallel chapters. Many Bible scholars in their eschatology, they call it the little apocalypse. And Jesus goes down and speaks about the different signs and wonders and different things that would take place on earth that we can mark them down on a prophetic line of history and see how close we are to the coming of the Lord. Now, what's interesting about Luke 21 and Matthew 24 is that Jesus combines several different events in the same description. Let's pick it up right here in verse 5. Luke chapter 21, beginning with verse 5. And the Bible says, are we all there together, friends? Amen. And as some spake of the temple, how it was adorned with goodly stones and gifts, he said, as for these things which ye behold, speaking of the temple, the days will come in the which there shall not be left one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And they asked him, saying, Master, but when shall these things be? And what sign will there be when these things shall come to pass? Now, Matthew 24 puts it a little bit differently. Turn there very quickly. Hold your finger in Luke chapter 21 and turn to Matthew chapter 24 to get another way of how the disciples asked that same question. Matthew 24, let's pick it up in verse 1. The Bible says, are we there together, friends? Amen. And Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him for to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said unto them, See ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. So far, it's clear that these two chapters are synonymous. They're parallel chapters. Amen? Same thing being described. Now the disciples, it's in Matthew, there's something else that's added here in their question. In Luke chapter 21, they simply ask, what are the signs when these things will come to pass? But Matthew 24 adds another question. Notice what it says in verse 3. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, Tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign of what? Of thy coming, and of what else? The end of the world. And Jesus answered and said, Let take heed that no man deceive you. Now go back to Luke chapter 21. We're going to find out that it's the same discourse here. In Luke chapter 21, he's asked the same things. What shall be the sign of these things? What shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? And Luke chapter 21, he says in verse 8, Take heed that ye be not deceived. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and the time draweth near. Go ye not therefore after them. But when ye shall hear of wars and commotions, be not terrified, for these things must first come to pass, but the end is not by and by. Now, he goes down through different signs, earthquakes and famines and pestilences in diverse places. And then he begins speaking of the destruction of Jerusalem. So in this discourse, there's several different things combined. He deals with the destruction of Jerusalem, as well as the sign of the second coming and the end of the world. So there's a combination of a description here. And I understand that to be that there's really parallels. That the destruction of Jerusalem really is a symbol of the destruction of the end of the world. Matter of fact, Ellen White herself in the book Great Controversy. By a show of hands, how many of you have ever read the book The Great Controversy? Okay? If you're an Adventist, I believe you should have, every single one of us should read that book. That book was to be circulated to the entire world. So if the whole world's supposed to read it, we should read it first. Amen? And the very first chapter of that book is called The Destruction of Jerusalem. And she parallels that the terrors of that day when Jerusalem was destroyed is a parallel of what will take place when Christ comes as well. Now, my point being, the reason I'm emphasizing that is because at the end of this, when he talks about the parable of the fig tree, he tells his hearers then that this generation will not pass until all these things be fulfilled. And that was literally fulfilled. A biblical generation is oftentimes, and usually, not always, but usually 40 years. And so when Jesus was talking to the people back then, standing on the Mount of Olives, just prior, because Luke chapter 22, verse 1 is the feast of Passover when he's betrayed. So we know that this is the year 31 AD when he does this prophecy. Correct? It's 31 AD. He was baptized in 27 AD. He was crucified 3.5 years later in the spring of 31. Correct? Are you all familiar with that? So when he's talking to the disciples saying that this generation will not pass until all things be fulfilled, that was 31 AD. And sure enough, within a generation, 39 years, just 1 year shy of that 40, that time clock, 70 AD, Jerusalem was destroyed. That generation did not pass away until all his words were fulfilled. But the interesting thing is, Jesus does that for a second reason. Not only does Jerusalem symbolize the destruction of the end of the world, but also he was confirming that if my words would come to pass that accurately, right on time, for Jerusalem, then you can bet that my words will come to pass just prior to my second coming. Are you all with me, friends? And he gives a sign for us in the last days that when you see these things come to pass, then know that this generation will not pass away until all these things be fulfilled. And what is that sign? It's the sign of the fig tree. Let's go ahead and look at that now. Luke chapter 21. Are we all there together, friends? Still amen? Are you getting the context here? So Luke chapter 21, and now let's pick it up in verse 25. Luke 21 and verse 25. Pardon me, I'm going to just grab my water I left down there. Luke chapter 21 and verse 25. And the Bible says, And there shall be signs in the sun, and in the moon, and in the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations and with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring. It's a lot in here I'm going to skip over. A lot of information, but that we don't have time to get into tonight. But it says, men's hearts failing them for fear, for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. Then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. When these things begin to come to pass, then look up, lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. And he spake to them a what? Spake them a parable. It's a symbol here. Behold, the fig tree. And all the trees, when they now what? When they now shoot forth, ye see and know of your own selves that what? Summer is now nigh at hand. So likewise ye, when ye see these things come to pass, know ye that the kingdom of God is nigh at hand. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass away till all be fulfilled. So Jesus now, with prophetic eye, looking down to the end of time in our generation, gives us a sign of the fig tree shooting forth and just prior to summertime. And when that takes place, when you see these things, which we'll discuss what these things are, when you see these things that are connected with causing the fig tree to shoot forth just prior to summertime, then know that this generation will not pass away. So what does it all mean? Well, when Jesus spoke in parables, he spoke in symbols. So we have to go into the Bible to start to investigate and discern what he's talking about here. Is that all right? So let's talk about that first. Let's go ahead and work from the back to the front. So let's go to the end where it talks about the summertime. Because the point he's trying to make is that you need to look at these signs prior to summertime. You know that summertime's nigh at hand. When summertime comes, we're going to find out that it's too late. The Bible says in the book of Jeremiah. What book are we going to? The book of Jeremiah, chapter 8. Now, many of you may be familiar with these things already. Some others may not. But as I once heard it said many years ago by a pastor friend of mine, that repetition deepens the impression. And so we don't mind going back over some of these things. Amen? Jeremiah chapter 8, and let's go ahead and look at what the Bible says here in verse 19. Actually, let's pick it up in verse 18. The Bible says in Jeremiah chapter 8, verse 18. We all there, friends? Amen? The Bible says, when I would comfort myself against sorrow, my heart is faint in me. Behold, the voice of the cry of the daughter of my people because of them that dwell in a far country. And by the way, that far country that Jeremiah is speaking of is the country of the north, which that's the context, which is a whole different topic for a whole different time. So there's a mourning taking place because of the armies of the north coming into the land. All right? Is not the Lord in Zion? Is not her king in her? Why have they provoked me to anger with their graven images and with their strange vanities? And then verse 20, it says, the harvest is what? The harvest is past. The summer is what? Ended, and we are not saved. For the hurt of the daughter of my people am I hurt. I am black. Astonishment had taken hold on me. Is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no physician there? Why then is not the health of the daughter of my people recovered? So when you look at the context, when the harvest comes, the harvest is connected to the summertime. Even in our context today, when do you go out and harvest things? You harvest in what? In the summertime. When the summer's done, it's the harvest is over and that's it, right? And by the way, what are you doing in the summertime? What are you doing during the harvest? You're gathering in what? You're gathering in the fruits of the earth, correct? So once the harvest is over, the summer is ended, it's too late. There's no more a physician there. There's no more balm in Gilead to heal your sin-sick soul. There's no more salvation. Probation is closed. Are you all with me so far? Now, why am I emphasizing that? Because Jesus says in Luke chapter 21 that you need to pay attention not to the summer, but to when there's the fig tree and the trees are beginning to shoot forth. You know that summer is right around the corner. And when summertime comes, it's too late. Are you all with me, friends? So the summer is the harvest. So what is that shooting forth? What is that shooting forth or that springing forth? This is a synonymous term that's used oftentimes in the scripture. Let's go ahead and look at what the Bible says here very quickly in the book of Isaiah. The book of Isaiah, and I just hope that you'll be with me tonight. I'm sure it's been a long week. How many of you have had a long week? Has it been a long week? All right, some of you don't want to admit it. It's been a long week. And so I just want to say that, I appreciate the fact that you've come all the way out here to listen to the Word of God. So if you've done that, then God will bless you for you choosing to place yourself in the channel of blessing. Amen? Let's go ahead and notice what that springing forth is. Let's go ahead and notice what that Bible says in Isaiah chapter 61. Isaiah chapter 61 and verse 11. This is just one text, as many that we can use. This is one of my favorites. Isaiah 61, verse 11, the Bible says, "For as the earth bringeth forth her bud, and as the garden causeth the things that are sown in it to what? Spring forth, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring forth before all the nations." So when a garden shoots forth or springs forth, it's bringing forth the bud, and it's bringing forth, it says right here, so that we can spring forth righteousness and praise before all the nations. It's bringing forth the fruits of righteousness. Can we say amen to that? Now, what is it that causes this springing forth or this shooting forth? Biblically, as well as agriculturally, what is it that causes the garden to spring forth just prior to the summertime? It's the rain. Go to Isaiah 55. These are some basic texts here. Isaiah chapter 55. Isaiah chapter 55. We're just putting some puzzle pieces together, and then we'll get into the heart or the meat of the matter. Isaiah chapter 55, the Bible says in verse 10 and 11, what is it that causes the seed to bud or the garden to spring forth? It's the rain. Isaiah 55, verses 10 and 11. Are we all there together, friends? Amen? "For as the rain cometh down, and the snow from heaven, and returneth not thither," but what does it do? It what? "It waters the earth, and makes it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it." So there's another text, that it's the rain that causes the garden to bring forth and spring forth and bud. Are we all together, friends? All right, so let's put together some puzzle pieces, and I'm going to start writing some things on the board so that I don't see the droopy eyes. Amen? All right, so let's go ahead and look at that. So we're working from the back to the front. So Jesus says that when you see the fig tree spring forth, bud forth, you know that summer is nigh, right? Now, did he tell us to pay attention to summer, or did he tell us to pay attention to spring? Spring. Why? Because summer equals what? Summer equals the harvest, and when the harvest comes, it says that we are not saved. That symbolizes the close of probation. Are we all together, friends? COP, close of probation. That's what it means right there. It's just a little abbreviation. So Jesus says, when the summer comes, harvest is done, we're not saved, probation's ended. He points us not to the summer, but he points us to the spring when the fig tree and all the trees begin to do what? Shoot forth. Is that what he said? Another scripture said it's also called the springing forth, right? To shoot forth is to spring forth, or it's to bud. Other scriptures say it's to blossom. The point being, it's to bring forth fruit. The fruits of what? The fruits of righteousness. Now, does everyone here understand that when Jesus is speaking about the trees, he's speaking about us? Do you all understand that? If you don't, just very quickly, if you're already in Isaiah, let's go back very briefly to Isaiah 61. And let's notice that whom? When it speaks about the trees bringing forth fruit, who does Jesus want to bring forth fruit? What trees? It's us, brothers and sisters. I remember years ago, many years ago now, I've heard a quote. I think I first heard this quote from Christ's Object Lessons, page 69, back in 1999. And I never forgot it. And someone was saying, quoting it, that when the character of Christ is, you all know it, say it with me, when the character of Christ is perfectly reproduced in his people, what? Then he shall come and claim them as his own. How many of you have ever heard that quotation before? So Jesus is waiting for what? Waiting for us. I'll show that to you in just a minute. Isaiah 61, verse 3. Isaiah 61, verse 3, we are the trees of righteousness to bring forth fruit. The Bible says, to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give unto them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they might be called the what? The trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he might be glorified. Go to the book of James very quickly. The book of James tells us clearly that Jesus is waiting not for another sign, he's waiting for us. He's waiting for the fruits of righteousness to be manifest in our lives. Can you say amen, brothers and sisters? James chapter 5, you know what's interesting? It's always easy to intellectually say amen. It's another thing to actually demonstrate the fruit. You know that, right? It's always easy to say, amen. I agree, well, I'm on my way to hell. It's easy to intellectually assent to mental intellectual information, but it's another matter to have it practically manifest in our lives and in our experience, isn't it? It's one thing to say, yes, I believe in having the character of Christ, and I believe that we have to have victory over sin. And you know, this false gospel saying you're going to be saving your sins, you're all going to hell, and yet we have sin in our life. And so it's one thing to have intellectual information, it's another thing to translate it down into a practical experience, right? I'll tell you what, friends, the practical experience is the Christian rubber hitting the road. It's really what it is. You know where the Christian rubber hits the road? In your home and in your family. That's one of the reasons why I try to emphasize family unity, brothers and sisters. You know the Elijah message? A lot of people say the Elijah message is a specific man or it's a specific message. And the Elijah message, brothers and sisters, if you want to really boil it down to what the Bible says, is turning the hearts of the fathers to the children and the hearts of the children of the fathers. You know that, don't you? It's so amazing to me how we oftentimes miss practical Christianity 101 in all of our intellectual prophetic study. Now, I'm in no way, and I know that Pastor Sankey's in agreement with me on this. That's why I'm saying it. I'm not, because I know he agrees with me. I've lectured with him all over the world. And so practical Christianity 101 cannot be divorced from an intellectual understanding of prophecy. If my understanding of Bible prophecy is not making me more kind and Christ-like and humble, then there's something wrong. There's something wrong, maybe not in the message, but there's something wrong in my experience. And so what Jesus is waiting for is not another camp meeting or a prophecy seminar or a convocation. Jesus is waiting for the fruits of righteousness to be manifest in our lives in a practical, hands-on, day-by-day way, in the way that I speak to my children, in the way that I deal with my wife, in the way that my wife loves and respects me as well, and which means you have to spend time with your wives, husbands, by the way, and maybe I'll come back and do a family seminar, won't I? But we have to be able to spend some time with our family, because the reason why, and I'm going to say this, the reason why there's so many problems in the church is because we have problems in our home. And the church is a microcosm of a bunch of families. And so whatever issues we have, we take them into the church. You know that, don't you? And so if you have a messed up home, you have a messed up church. And if you have a messed up church, then you have a messed up society. And so what we're doing is we're going out there knocking on doors. Oh, hi, guys. Oh, we put on these smiley faces. And we go out there and try to witness and give out tracts. Would you like to be unchristlike like me? Would you like to have the perversion of character like me? And people can look through it, and they can see that we're hypocrites, and a lot of young people are turned off. And so in all of what I'm talking about tonight, which I'm not trying to emphasize family right now, I can maybe do that later on another time, but what I want to talk about tonight is that Jesus is waiting for the fruits of righteousness, the fruit of the Spirit, to be manifest in our lives, that it can couple with a prophetic understanding to know the signs of the times that we're almost when Jesus is going to come, and so I need an experience with Christ. I have to get on my face and on my knees and ask Jesus to empty me of the worst enemy in the world, which is self, and become Christ-like, and get victory over my impatience and my irritation and my hasty speech. You know, brothers and sisters, Christianity is a lot simpler than we think, and we make it complicated. James chapter 5, go there very quickly. James chapter 5 and verse 7. James chapter 5 and verse 7, and notice what the Bible says. You know, that's one of the dangers of being a Seventh-day Adventist. By the way, I don't regret being a Seventh-day Adventist. I'm ruined now. I can't go anywhere else. I know too much. People say, your church's all messed up. Why don't you go somewhere else? I can't. I know too much. We have the truth. But the problem is we have so much truth is that we make that truth an excuse to not be a Christian. And so what we do is we put up man-made tests to other people to say, you can be saved if you intellectually assent to all the mental information. And this is a Pharisaical works religion that has nothing to do with the grace of God or salvation in Jesus Christ. And so there has to be a blending of the intellectual and spiritual so that you cannot be moved. Does that make sense, friends? James chapter 5, verse 7. That's not my point tonight, but I wanted to still emphasize that as a point because this really the center of all things, is it not? James chapter 5, verse 7. Let's go there very quickly. Are we all there together, friends? Amen? The Bible says, this right here, friends, this is the principle of Christ's object lessons, page 69, right here. Be patient, therefore, brethren, unto the coming of the Lord. Behold, the husbandman waiteth for another Bible prophecy seminar to take place. Behold, the husbandman waiteth for another, what? He's waiting for the precious fruits of the earth. And he hath long patience for it until he received the early and latter rain. Be ye also patient. Establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord, what? Draw nigh. And then I love it. In the context of that the Lord is coming, he's waiting for the precious fruit of the earth in the time of the latter rain, he gives the context and the point. He says, so therefore, grudge not one against another, brethren, lest ye be condemned. Behold, the judge standeth before the door. There's so much symbolism right there. The judge standing, the door, all these different things. But it's very interesting that that's the problem we have. You know, I believe the Bible tells the truth. How many of you believe the Bible tells the truth? So I believe that the Bible is adapted to the needs of man. And so therefore, the Lord knows that us in the last days, just before the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, when the Lord is waiting for the fruit of the earth to be manifest in the time of a latter rain, we would be doing something, we'd be grudging against one another. But that's a different topic for a different time, isn't it? Let's go back to Luke chapter 21. What's the sign? The summer is the harvest. The harvest is also the end of the world. Matthew chapter 13 explains that. The fig tree, he's saying, wait for the spring. When you see it shoot forth, when you see it spring forth, when you see it bud and blossom, when you bring forth fruits of righteousness, then know that summer's almost here, because now I can harvest you. Right? So the question is, what is the sign of these things when we know that it's time for the shooting forth and the time of the latter rain? Are you all with me so far? Because we all agree that the shooting forth or the springing forth is caused by the rain, correct? So how do we, and what is Jesus waiting for? He's waiting for the early and latter rain. So how do we know, what is the sign of thy coming, Lord? What is the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? Well, I'll tell you what it is, he says. When you see the fig tree shoot forth, when you see the latter rain, when you see the sign, when this begins to take place, then know that the harvest is right around the corner and that this generation won't pass away. So turn with me now to the book of Amos. The book of Amos, chapter 7 in the Old Testament. And I'm going to give you just a moment to find that. Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Amos. Amos chapter 7 and verse 1. The Bible tells us a sign. When Jesus says, when you see these things come to pass, then know that this generation will not pass away. Amos chapter 7, verse 1, the Bible says, and when you're there, amen. What is the sign of thy coming, Lord, and of the end of the world? Thus hath the Lord God showed unto me, says Amos, and behold, he formed what? Grasshoppers, when? In the beginning of the shooting up of the latter growth, and lo, it was the latter growth after the king's mowings. Now, wait a minute. Let's go ahead and break down some of that archaic Old English language. Is that all right? Because some of you got it and some of you didn't. Let's go from back to front once again. Now, what is the king's mowings? So it's talking, obviously, about a harvest. It's talking about something growing up, right? There's a shooting forth, there's a latter growth, and there's a king's mowings. Now, what happens, come on, work with me now, what happened in old days when there was the springing forth, the rain came down, there was the latter growth. So the latter growth would be in the time of the latter rain, correct? And the king now would come and mow it down. What do you call it when you come and mow down the harvest? It's a reaping, right? Or maybe I gave you the answer in that, right? It's the harvest, correct? So when you come and mow it, this is the last of the king's harvest. And so he says, look, I'm going to give you a sign. When you see the grasshoppers come into the land, you know that you're in the beginning of the latter growth. You're in the beginning of the latter rain, and it's the final harvest, the king's harvest. Are you with me, friends? So Amos chapter 7, verse 1 tells us the sign. He tells us what it is to look for when we know that we're in the beginning of the latter rain of the final harvest, and it's the grasshoppers. Did you get it? And you say, what's the big deal? What's a grasshopper in prophecy? Well, if you come to this church, or any of the other present true church, I'm sure you probably know what a grasshopper symbolizes in prophecy. But in case you don't, let's go ahead and look at that. Is that all right? Because there's another second witness that tells us that the shooting forth takes place in the day of the grasshopper. But in Isaiah chapter 27, it says a little bit different. Go to Isaiah 27 very quickly. Let's go ahead and write this on the board. So what is the sign? It's when you see the what? When you see the grasshoppers, that you know that you are in the beginning the beginning of the what? Of the shooting forth, of the latter growth, of the king's harvest. Are you all with me, friends? So what are these grasshoppers? Go to Isaiah 27. Let's get a second witness very quickly about the shooting forth and that this is the last harvest. Isaiah 27, very quickly, let's notice what the Bible says here. Isaiah chapter 27. Because one thing I want you to understand here very quickly, I might just need to back up real quick, slow down, and just give you a few puzzle pieces to make the picture a little bit better. Isaiah 27 is a song, and God is singing to his vineyard. And I want you to write down in your notes that in the Bible, especially the Old Testament, a vineyard and a fig tree was symbolic of Israel. All right? So what did I say again? Vineyard, a vine or a vineyard, and a fig tree was symbolic of what? Of Israel. Let me just show that to you very quickly. Let's see, there's a couple of scriptures I can give. Let's go to the book of Judges very quickly. Let's go to the book of Judges chapter 9. Let me give you a few scriptures very quickly to show you that oftentimes the vine, the vineyard, and the fig tree were symbols of national Israel, God's people, God's denominated people. Judges chapter 9, and I want to go with here very quickly to verse 8. We're going to be reading a very interesting story. This was a parable that was told many years ago in the days of the judges. And we're in Judges chapter 9, beginning with verse 8. And when you're there, you can just let me know. Amen? All right, while you're there, I'm actually looking up another script. There it is. Okay. Judges chapter 9, verse 8. The trees went forth on a time to anoint a king over them. And they said unto the olive tree, reign thou over us. But the olive tree said unto them, should I leave my fatness, wherewith by me they honor God and man, and go to be promoted over the trees? And the tree said to the fig tree, come thou reign over us. But the fig tree said unto them, should I forsake my sweetness, my good fruit, and go to be promoted over the trees? And then said the trees unto the vine, come thou reign over us. The vine said unto them, should I leave my wine, which cheereth God and man, and go to be promoted over the trees? And then said all the trees unto the bramble, the thorn bush, come down, reign over us. And the bramble said unto the trees, if in truth you anoint me king over you, then come and put your trust in my shadow. And if not, let fire come out of the bramble and devour the cedars of Lebanon. This is a very interesting parable here. It was dealing with the anointing of kings. However, there's also some symbolism there, that when it comes to God's people, God represented his people in their fatness, in their sweetness, and their cheerfulness for God and man as an olive tree, as a fig tree, and as a vine. Are you all with me, friends? When they forsook God, they became known as a thorn bush. They brought forth thorns and briars. Now, let me give you some other proof text showing that the vineyard or the vine represents Israel before we go back to Isaiah 27. Go to Psalm 80. Psalm what division? Psalm 80. Psalm 80 in verse 8. Let's notice another parable here. Psalm 80. Beginning with verse 8. When you have that, amen. You're all still with me, right? I haven't lost you yet? Okay. Just making sure. I know it's been a long week and we're all probably tired. It's really warm in here. Psalm 80, verse 8. The Bible says, thou hast brought a what? A vine out of where? Egypt. And thou hast cast out the heathen and planted it. Thou preparedst room before it, and didst cause it to take deep root, and it filled the land. The hills were covered with the shadow of it, and the boughs thereof were like the goodly cedars. She sent out her boughs into the sea, and her branches unto the river. Why hast thou then broken down her hedges, so that all they which pass by the way do pluck her? And so here we have an obvious parable, or we have this symbolism of God bringing Israel out of Egypt, casting out the heathen and planting them in the Canaan land, from the river to the sea. Right, from the Jordan River all the way down to the Mediterranean. And so here Israel is represented as a what? As a vine. A vine is planted in a vineyard, correct? So we have olive trees, we have fig trees, we have vines and vineyards all representing Israel. Now with that in our minds, matter of fact, can I give you one more proof text? Is that okay? You don't mind, do you? I only see you once every 7 years, so I'll give you a few scriptures to last you, all right? Go to the book of Hosea very quickly. Hosea chapter 9. Let me give you one more proof text, Hosea chapter 9, that the fig tree represents Israel as well. Hosea chapter 9, the Bible says in verse 10, remember the vine and the fig tree. Hosea chapter 9, verse 10. We there, friends? Amen? The Lord says, I found who? Israel, like what? Grapes in the wilderness. Pause. Where do grapes, what do grapes grow on? A vine. So Israel's like a vine that produces grapes, but it's also like a fig tree. Notice, I saw your fathers as the first ripe in the fig tree at her first time, but they went to Baal Peor and separated themselves unto that shame, and their abominations were according as they loved. So God says, I found you as a fruitful vine. I found you as a fruitful fig tree. So the vine and the fig tree represent Israel, represent God's people. Amen? Now, with that in your mind, go back to Isaiah 27. And notice, because we're talking about the sign that the fruit should be produced on the fig tree is that grasshoppers come into the land. Isaiah says it differently. He doesn't talk about the fig tree, he talks about the vine. And he talks about the vine producing fruit. And he talks about the vine producing fruit in the same day as the grasshoppers, but there he calls it not the day of the grasshoppers, he calls it the day of the east wind. Go to Isaiah 27 and notice what the Bible says now in verse 2. Isaiah 27, verse 2, the Bible says, and in that day sing ye unto her, a what? A vineyard of red wine. I, the Lord, do keep it. I will water it every moment, lest any hurt it. I will keep it night and day. Why is God watering his vineyard? So it can what? It can produce fruit. Fury is not in me. Who would set the briars and thorns against me in battle? I will go through them. I would burn them together. Or let him take hold of my strength, that he may make peace with me, and he shall make peace with me. Verse 6, here it is. He shall cause them that come of Jacob to take root. Israel shall do what? Shall blossom and bud. They shall spring forth and fill the face of the world with fruit. How? Verse 8, in measure when it does what? It shoots or springs forth, thou wilt debate with it. He stayeth his rough wind in the day of the what? The east wind. So the day of the east wind is the day when the Lord is wanting Israel to blossom and bud and to fill the face of the world with fruit. It's when the Lord is watering the vineyard. Are you all with me, friends? It's the day of the east wind. Now, when you look at this, friends, what's the point? Why does the Lord want to send us the rain so that we can shoot forth and have fruit? It's the very next verse in verse 9. By this, therefore, by the rain coming down, by producing fruit in your life, by this, therefore, shall the what? The iniquity of Jacob be blotted out, brothers and sisters. And this is all the fruit to take away his sin. When he maketh all the stones of the altar, those false altars, as chalk stones that are beaten asunder, the groves and the images in our lives, friends, shall not stand up. So the Lord is wanting to eradicate sin in our lives by understanding that in the day of the rain, in this last day, when we understand that just prior to the harvest, when there's going to be probation closed, we need to understand that the Lord wants us to spring forth and bring forth the fruits of righteousness. Amen? Now, what day? What was the sign that Jesus gave? What was the sign that Jesus gave to know that we're in the beginning of the latter growth of the shooting forth of the trees? What was it? What did Amos say? The Lord has shown me something. He showed me what? He showed me grasshoppers. Isaiah says, it's the day of the east wind when I saw this. So when you see grasshoppers in the day of the east wind, then know that this generation will not pass away until Jesus comes. Are you understanding the point? And Jesus gave this parable back in the days of Jerusalem and said, when you see that sign of it being surrounded with armies, then know that that generation won't pass away. And sure enough, 39 years just prior to 40, it was done. That generation not pass away. And Jesus says, you want to know when I'm coming back? When you see the fig tree shooting forth in the day of the east wind, when the grasshoppers come, then know that this generation will not pass away until Jesus comes. Now, what are the grasshoppers? Now, in order to explain that, I have to go ahead and go to a little bit more Bible study. Is that all right? Is it okay? Can we have a little bit more time tonight? Is that okay? You're all still with me, amen? So I think it's pretty important to discern what the grasshoppers are, if that's the sign that this generation is about, that's it. We're living in the final generation, brothers and sisters. That's, to me, that's phenomenal. And it's really a wake-up call to know that this generation, that some of you in this room will be alive to see our Lord Jesus Christ come the second time. And I pray that even some in this room may be alive and not die may be translated without seeing death. And we'll talk about that tomorrow. But this generation, brothers and sisters. Now, what are the grasshoppers? What are the grasshoppers? Now, first of all, let's go ahead and do some connecting the dots. Is that all right? Let's go ahead and look at the fact that the east wind is always connected to bringing grasshoppers. Is that all right? So once again, we're going to work from the back to the front. Is that okay? So let's first of all connect the east wind and the grasshoppers in Exodus chapter 10. Exodus, what chapter are we going to? Exodus chapter 10. Let's notice the plagues on Egypt. Now, there's a lot of symbolism here I just don't have time to get into. We know that this is a symbol of the end of the world as well. You all know that the plagues on Egypt symbolize the plagues on the world in the end of time, right? Egypt is a symbol of the world. You know, what's interesting is that the seven last plagues have their parallel in the seven plagues that fell upon Egypt. And you know how many plagues were there on Egypt total? There was 10. But three of them affected not only the Egyptians, but also Israel as well, that was in the land of Goshen, correct? And then after the first three plagues, Israel and the land of Goshen were spared, and only seven plagues fell only specifically, exclusively on Egypt itself. So the seven plagues that only affected Egypt represent the seven plagues that affect the world in the end of time. So when we look at one of the plagues, Exodus chapter 10, it's the plague of locusts. The Bible says in Exodus chapter 10, notice where they come from in verse 12. Exodus chapter 10, beginning with verse 12. The Bible says, and when you're there together, friends, amen. Who are these locusts? Who are these grasshoppers? The Bible says, Exodus chapter 10, verse 12, and the Lord said unto Moses, stretch out thine hand over the land of Egypt for the locusts, that they may come up upon the land of Egypt and eat every herb of the land, even all that the hail had left. And Moses stretched forth his rod over the land of Egypt, and the Lord brought a what? An east wind upon the land all that day and all that night. And when it was morning, the east wind brought the locust. Now, by the way, I guess I didn't ask the question, but does it go without saying that grasshoppers and locusts are synonymous biblical terms? Is that all right? Is that okay? Because in the Bible, you'll sometimes see it mentioned as grasshoppers, other times mentioned as locusts. It's the same insect. Okay, I don't think we have to have an anthropological debate over that. Okay, entomology dictates that a grasshopper and a locust are the same insect, even though they have some metamorphosis there when they begin to migrate, etc. But it's the same insect. Is that okay? All right, good. Thank you very much. I didn't do bad for ninth grade, did I? East wind brings the grasshoppers or the locusts. Now, let's go ahead and look at a little bit more about these locusts or grasshoppers, because when they swarm and when they come into the land, they devour, they destroy, do they not? Isn't that what it just said right there? They're going to come and destroy the land. Now, it's interesting what else they're connected to in the book of Judges. Go there very quickly in the book of Judges. And notice that the grasshoppers or locusts in the book of Judges, when they come into the land of Israel, they destroy it, but they're identified as a people group. Judges chapter 6. The Bible says in Judges chapter 6, when we're all there, amen, we're going to read verses 3 through 5. Judges chapter 6, verses 3 through 5. The Bible says, and so it was, when Israel had sown, that the Midianites came up, and the Amalekites, and the children of the west. All right, amen. Don't always believe your preacher, right? And the children of which direction? Of the east, even they came up against them, and they encamped against them, and destroyed the increase of the earth, till thou come unto Gaza. And they left no sustenance for Israel, neither sheep, nor ox, nor ass, for they came up with their cattle and their tents, and they came as what? Grasshoppers for multitude, for both they and their camels were without number, and they entered into the land to do what? To destroy it. So here we have once again the symbolism of grasshoppers, locusts destroying the land, and they also come from which direction? From the east. But now they're called the children of the east. Did you get that? Let's go ahead and write that down as well. So not only do they come from the direction of the east, but they're also called the children of the east. Let's go ahead and look at the next chapter. Go to Judges chapter 7. Let's get another witness there. Judges chapter 7, same information here. Judges chapter 7 and verse 12. The Bible says, and the Midianites and the Amalekites and all the children of the east lay along in the valley like grasshoppers for multitude, and their camels were without number, as the sand by the seaside for multitude. By the way, did you get the animal twice that mentioned the animal that they ride? What animal? So the children of the east ride camels. Did you get that? Let's go ahead and get another witness. Remember, we're working from back to front. So who are these children of the east that ride upon camels that come and attack Israel? Go to Jeremiah. Let's find out. Jeremiah, you know what I love about the Bible? Is you can just piece it together. It's called proof texting. And prove your point. Let's notice what the Bible says in Jeremiah chapter 49. Jeremiah 49, verses 28 and 29. Now, do I need to write these scriptures on the board, or are you following along? Is that okay? How many of you are A-plus students and writing down all these things? Oh, pfft. I saw two hands go like this. Anybody writing these things down? All right, good. So if you're not, go to the smart kids of the class, and you can get all the notes afterward. Amen? Jeremiah 49, verses 28 and 29. Who are these children of the east that ride upon camels? The Bible says in Jeremiah 49, are we all there together, friends? Amen? Concerning who? Kedar. I'm going to write that down before I forget. Let's write that down. Kedar. Because we're going to come back to this man, Kedar. Who is that Kedar? Concerning Kedar and concerning the kingdoms of Hazor, which Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, shall smite. Thus saith the Lord, arise ye, go up to Kedar and spoil the men of the east. Their tents and their flock shall they take away. They shall take to themselves their curtains and all their vessels and what else? And their camels. And they shall cry unto them, fear is on every side. So do we see a connection so far? Can we see that the children of the east are also called the men of the east that ride upon camels and they are of the tribe of Kedar? How many of you got that? Did you get that? So who's Kedar? Let's notice who Kedar is. Go to the book of Isaiah. The book of Isaiah chapter 21. Isaiah chapter 21, who is Kedar? Notice what the Bible says in Isaiah 21, verse 13 through 17. And when you're there, amen. Isaiah prophesies. I'll say it one more time in case you were writing it down. Isaiah 21, beginning with verse 13. This is a prophecy or a burden upon which area of the world? Arabia. In the forest in Arabia shall you lodge, O ye traveling companies of Edom. The inhabitants of the land of what? I'm going to write that down as well because whoever's in Arabia, they are the inhabitants of Tema. They're called Tema. Are you with me, friends? I'm going to put down that as well. I'll put Tema in there. So Tema, this is the land of Arabia, correct? Let's notice who else is there. The inhabitants of the land of Tema brought water to him that was thirsty. They prevented with their bread him that fled. For they fled from the swords, from the drawn sword, and from the bent bow, and from the grievousness of war. For thus hath the Lord said to me, within a year, according to the years of a hireling, and all the glory of who? Kedar shall fail. Wait a minute. So we have Tema, and we have Kedar over there where? In Arabia, verse 17. And the residue of the number of archers, the mighty men of the children of Kedar, that's the children of the east, shall be diminished, for the Lord God of Israel has spoken this. So friends, follow with me now. So the grasshoppers that come from the east are also the children of the east. They ride upon camels. They're of the tribes of Kedar and Tema, and they live where? In Arabia. Are you all with me, friends? Maybe you're not convinced yet. Go to Ezekiel chapter 27. Where are we going, friends? Ezekiel 27. And let's get another witness that Kedar is also Arabia. Ezekiel 27 and verse 21. I'll say it one more time for those taking notes. Ezekiel chapter 27. And verse 21, and notice that Kedar are also called the princes of Arabia. The Bible says in Ezekiel 27, 21, is a prophecy about who? Arabia and all the princes of Kedar. They occupy with thee in lambs and rams and goats. In these were they thy merchants. So here we have another witness that Arabia and Kedar are connected. So the question now is who on earth is Kedar and Tema? Go back to Genesis chapter 25. You know, there's a reason why God worked, there's a reason why the Holy Spirit preserved for our records all this genealogy. How many of you ever read the genealogies before and got like really bogged down? Anybody? And Salu was the son of, and the son of, and the son of, and the son of, and a lot of these things you can't ever hardly, you know, pronounce, right? Some interesting names in there, by the way. I used to kid with my wife and, before she ever got pregnant with any child, I said, honey, we ever have a son? It's like one of the, you know, the Book of Chronicles. And there was some children there called Hupim and his brother Mupim. I said, honey, we ever have a son? Hoopum Moopum Richards. You know, it sounds. And her answer to me was, no. I'm sure it was beautiful back then. That little baby Hoopum and his brother Moopum. But there's actually a reason why there's a genealogy. The genealogy is that the Jews considered genealogy sacred. It showed, you know, by the way, friends, even to this day, even though that you might not be into genealogies, we're still into our roots, are we not? Knowing who you are, where you came from, there's a sense of connection, is there not? And when you really go back far enough, there's a connection to the whole human family. There's a whole web of the human family. And so Genesis 25 gives the history of who Kedar and Tema were. I want to show that to you very quickly in Genesis chapter 25. Genesis 25, beginning with verse 12. And we're going to notice the genealogy of a man named Ishmael. Now, by a show of hands, how many of you have ever heard of that name, Ishmael? Yeah, Ishmael? Who is Ishmael? Firstborn son of Abraham. He was a son of Abraham through a concubine named Hagar. He was a son of works, not of faith, right? The Apostle Paul likens Hagar to Mount Sinai, whereas he likens Sarah unto through Isaac as being the child of faith and showing the difference between faith and works. It's a very interesting parallel that Paul uses, but it's true. Abraham was trying to work in order to receive the promise of God, but you can't receive a promise by works. If it's promised, it's a gift, right? And so he received the promise of God by faith, and therefore he became the friend of God, and therefore we all become the children of faith and the children of Abraham, which means that every one of us, if we're under the new covenant, we're actually under the Abrahamic covenant. Kind of interesting principle. That's a whole different topic for a whole different time. But if you are under the new covenant, you are under the same covenant that Abraham was under. Yeah? You know, the Jews, I digress just a hair, but the Jews at Mount Sinai left the covenant of Abraham and the sign of circumcision, which represented a circumcised heart, and they went to the law of works, that all that the Lord has said, we will do, just like Abraham. Lord, I'll help you out. Let me help you out. Lord, how many of us have ever had that problem? Lord, let me just help you. I know you've lived for eternity. I'm 39, and I know quite a bit, so. You know. Let me help the eternal God to know what he's doing. You're all chuckling because it sounds ludicrous, doesn't it? And yet every one of us here, most likely, have had that experience, haven't we? Lord, I can't stand this. I can't deal with it. Let me just try. Anyone know what I'm talking about? I don't like this, Lord. Boo-hoo. You know, I was reminded, matter of fact, flying into L.A., I was actually reminded of a lot of things when I flew in. I was reminded of how I'm so glad I don't live here anymore. It was so clear. It's beautiful, by the way. It's all clear. It's so clear you can see all the graffiti and all the streets and the traffic. It's just kidding. Actually, I'm not kidding. But I was interested as I looked at that wide, vast city. You know, L.A., just, that guy coming in, you could see all the way from the hills, San Fernando Mountains, all the way to Long Beach. I could see coming in on the plane, you could see all the ships out in the Long Beach Harbor and even down almost to San Diego. It's just a beautiful, clear day. And as I was looking out at this vast city with all these people that are just needing Christ in their lives, I realized how big God is. You know, when you're on the ground, everything looks so big. Huge buildings, and they look so tiny. And you see the futility of man. I was reminded of that Spirit of Prophecy quote that no earthly buildings can withstand when they're shaking or burned. I'm thinking, how futile is man? It's such, you know, and that's just from my vantage point, just coming into LAX and seeing the city and seeing how small everything is, how easily everything is be wiped off. And the quote came to my mind, and I'm trying to remember exactly where it's found. If you have it, maybe you can help me, but it's an old quotation. I believe it's actually found in Desire of Ages where Mrs. White says something to the effect, forgive me if I paraphrase, but says that, talks about God from his great and calm eternity, his divine survey. Everything is open to his divine survey. And he from his great and calm eternity, he orders that which his providence sees best. Anyone ever familiar with that quotation? I know you're probably looking it up, right, Sankey? You're going to help me out, right? If you find that, go ahead and read it out, okay? But the point I'm trying to make is that, friends, I know it's a little bit of a segue, a little bit of a side note, but when we're going through struggles in our life, there's overwhelming experiences, when there's things that seem like they're out of our control, that's the perfect time to give it to the control of a God who holds up eternity. You understand how small we are, brothers and sisters? You know, there's a reason why Jesus became a man. Divinity joined humanity for all of eternity. And he came to experience what we go through as a man, as men, as women, as humans. And he had all these sermons where he's trying to calm your mind and says, look at the flowers. They don't toil and spin, yet your heavenly Father clothes the grass, the field. Even Solomon wasn't as beautiful as this. If God so clothes the grass, the field, will he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Look at the birds of the air. Jesus was trying to say, stop being so stressed out. Your heavenly Father knows the hairs on your head. He cares about you, and he understands what your needs are. And so while we struggle and stress, we forget the weightier matters of life, which is justice, mercy, faith, kindness, becoming humble Christians, becoming Christ-like. And he's saying, stop stressing out. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Your heavenly Father knows that you have need of these things. Amen? And so why am I saying that? Because Abraham didn't know that. Abraham? Yes, Lord? Lift up your eyes now and see if you can count the number of the stars. See if you can count the sand on the sea, so shall your seed be. But Lord, I don't have any children. Trust my promise, Abraham. Okay. Years go by and it's not realized. Right? And they start getting stressed out. Oh, man. Lord, you must do it through Eliezer. No, it's going to be your own son. But how? Sarah, I got it figured out. Let's help God. Marry somebody else. That's a good idea. Yeah, that sounds good. You know, when we're trying to help God, we usually make some big mistakes. And we make those big mistakes, they are not easily redeemed. It's better to wait upon God and allow God to follow through at his time. It's better to be in poverty and distress than to go running ahead of God or to straggle too far behind. It's better to, and safest to be in the center of God's holy will. Amen, friends? You know what? And it's a process of learning, isn't it? So this is not in any way bashing you. It's a process of learning how to trust and wait upon God. Be still. Know that I am God. Now, did you have that quote? You want to read it very quickly? Why don't you read it with your good baritone voice? Amen. Thank you so much. Genesis chapter 25, let's begin to wind this down. Genesis 25. There was a young boy named Ishmael. Ishmael, the child of works. And the children of Ishmael, notice what their names were in his genealogy. And we're in Genesis 25, beginning in verse 12. And when you have that, amen. The Bible says, now these are the generations of Ishmael, Abraham's son, whom Hagar, the Egyptian, Sarah's handmaid, bare unto Abraham. And these are the names of the sons of Ishmael by their names according to their generations. The firstborn of Ishmael was Nebajoth, and the secondborn's name was what? Kedar. And Adbeel, and Mibsam, and Mishma, Duman, Massah, Hadar, and who else? Timah, and Jetur, Naphish, and Kedamah. These are the sons of Ishmael, and these are their names by their towns, by their castles, 12 princes according to their nations. And so here we have named at least two sons. Did you get it? It was Timah, and who else? Kedar, who we already found out are the Arabians, the children of the east, that ride upon camels that come from the east, and they're symbolized as grasshoppers or locusts. Are you all with me, friends? And Ishmael's sons, or the Arabians, became what you now call today the modern-day Islamic nations. Yes or no? Can you name one Arabic nation that is not Muslim? Name one. Doesn't exist. Right? And so the modern day era, now you're all trying to think, oh, let me see if I can trip them up. Let's see. Oh, they're all Muslim. So the Arabic people became the Islamic people, and God said, Amos, I'm going to show you a sign. I'm going to show you a sign so you can know that you're in the beginning of the last harvest, just prior to the final harvest, the last one of the king's mowings. It's when you see the grasshoppers come in the land. It's the day of the east wind. And when you see Islam and prophecy come back raising their head, you know that this generation will not pass away until Jesus Christ comes a second time. And so where are we, friends? And without going into a whole other prophecy seminar, we are living, friends, in the seventh trumpet, the third woe, the third jihad. We're living when ISIS and the caliphate has risen back up. We're living in a time where radical Islam has proclaimed war, holy war against the West and Rome and the U.S., the armies of Rome. And friends, it's going to get worse. And you're going to see major catastrophic issues take place that will put San Bernardino look like child's play. And when these things begin to happen, lift up your heads because your redemption is drawing nigh. And friends, it's already begun. Let me ask you a question. When did the east wind affect this land? So September 11, 2001, you know what the Lord said? The Lord said, this generation won't pass away. Since the events of September 11, 2001, has Islam gone away? Or has it gotten worse and worse and worse and worse? What's the talking points now in this presidential election in the U.S.? What's one of the main talking points? ISIS, Homeland Security, safety. And friends, I'm going to tell you just very, very honestly, I used to believe that it was all a conspiracy years ago. Brothers and sisters, this is the real deal. These are not all Jesuits and growing their beards out and putting scarves on their heads and, you know, all these, whatever they call them. What are they called on their heads? Kufis or what is it? Oh, a little hat. I don't know what they're called. But you know what I'm talking about, right? You don't have enough Catholics to make up all this stuff, brothers and sisters. So this is the real deal. And by the way, does anyone know anything about ISIS? You know, does everyone know what ISIS is? Or some people call it ISIL, some people call it IS, the Islamic State. Anyone been hearing about this thing? If you're not hearing about it, you're in a cave somewhere. This is the issue today in the world. ISIS, let me just give you some very quick facts. Because what I'm trying to tell you is Jesus told us a sign. When you see this sign, you know that you're living in a time where you better be bringing forth fruit. We have to have the rain being in our lives so we can produce forth fruit, because the harvest is right around the corner. And this, listen to what I'm saying, this generation will not pass away. You hear what I'm saying? Since September 11, 2001, based upon the word of the Lord, this generation will not pass away until we see Jesus Christ come the second time. And that is deep, brothers and sisters. And I want you just to meditate upon that. It's like, is that really real? Because if that's real, we have some changing to do in our lives. If you really knew that it was that close, what would you be doing different? Let it crystallize in your brain and sink down into your ears that Jesus says that this generation will not pass away. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. ISIS has risen up, brothers and sisters. Let me just give you some quick facts. This is just one of the aspects, not the whole thing. That's not the whole burritos, but it's one of the major components. This is the first time that a caliphate has been proclaimed since the fall of the ancient Turkish Empire, the Ottoman Empire. Now, that's prophetically significant. Our early pioneers understood that the Islamic caliphate was a part and parcel of Bible prophecy, Revelation chapter 9. Matter of fact, it was so important to God that he put even time prophecy in there. 5 months and 391 years and 15 days. It's all right here on the prophecy charts. It was a major component of Bible prophecy back then. That was only the first and second woe. 1 + 2 = 3, the third woe will be even worse. This is the first time since the fall of the ancient Ottoman Empire that there is now a proclaimed caliphate, which is now an Islamic state directly under Sharia law, directly under Quranic law, under a successor of the Prophet Muhammad, under the Sunni. You know, the Sunnis and Shiites are a different faction. The Sunnis believe that there was the direct successor from Abu Bakr, okay? From Muhammad to his son-in-law Abu Bakr, and through a prophetic line that was broken after the Ottoman Empire fell. The Shiites, which are a minority, they're only about 10% of the Muslims out of the 1.3 Muslims in the world. The Shiites believe in a family lineage that it should have been the son-in-law and cousin of Muhammad himself. And so they go by a more of a family line. It's very interesting. The only nation in the world that is a Shiite nation is Iran. And Iran, by the way, are not Arabs. They're Persians. And this is a whole different issue. That's why there's a lot of infighting. Point being, since the proclamation of a caliphate just about, what was it now, a year and a half ago? The summer of 2014. Under the caliph Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi. The word al always means from, so he's Abu Bakr from Baghdad. So if you ever heard like al-Americani or al-Franki, is dealing with a Muslim name from France or from America or from Baghdad, etc. So he's Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi. He's taken the name of the successor of the Prophet Muhammad. Since that time, brothers and sisters, the American intelligence community, which oftentimes lies to you, are now trying to at least tell you what's going on now, and the figure keeps on getting worse. A year ago, they were estimating that it was somewhere around 20,000 troops that they had. It's not Al-Qaeda or a bunch of people in a closet. Now they're saying it's somewhere around 60,000 people. So the more they bomb them, the more they grow. They now control the territory of a third of the country. No, matter of fact, I take that back. They control the territory of almost half of of Iraq and almost about two-thirds of Syria. And they're just continuing to spread and spread and grow and grow. It's very interesting what's taking place. Think about that. Think about an actual army of Islamic people that 60,000 strong with American tanks, with military, with even jets. Did you know they had jets, by the way? Because they're taking over military bases. And you can't stop them. I'll tell you why. Because they've been loosed, brothers and sisters, by a divine power above man. You know, back in Revelation 9, a voice from the four horns of the golden altar said, loose the four angels. And that voice from the four horns of the golden altar was Christ as the mediator. So Jesus has loosed them and said, you better pay attention to the sign. Because the locusts do two things. Prophetically, they mark when the fruit should be growing, but if you don't have fruit, then they'll just eat you up. They devour. Those who do not have fruit, what do locusts do? What do locusts by nature do? They eat the grass, they eat the herbs, they eat everything of the land, except they're not allowed to touch somebody. Go there very quickly as we close. Go to Revelation chapter 9. I'm showing you, friends, from the Bible, from what thus saith the Lord, that we're living in the last days. We're living under the sounding of the seven trump, the third woe. We're living in a time where Jesus has said, when you see these things, then lift up your heads. Your redemption is drawing nigh. Revelation 9, I want to close in this thought. Friends, Jesus has given us yet a promise. If I had more time, I'd go into it. I'd go to the book of Joel and show how the locusts with teeth like lions bark the fig tree and eat up the vine. So those that are not producing fruit in God's church, those of you who proclaim to be Adventist, to proclaim to be spiritual Israel, those of you who proclaim, those of us, I'll include myself, if we're proclaiming and claiming to be the fig tree, if we're claiming to be the vine, and yet we're not bringing forth fruit, then we're devoured by the locusts in Joel chapter 1. And that's what happened with Jesus, wasn't it? He came to the fig tree, and what did it have on there? It had leaves. It was a profession. It was to cover up the nakedness of the soul. I don't have any fruits. I'm just going to give you my leaves, Lord. It's like Adam and Eve, right? I'm naked. I don't have any fruit, so let me just cover myself up with leaves. And Jesus says, I curse you. And it withered up from the roots. And so there's only two choices. You're either a bare fig tree to be eaten by the locusts, or you're a fruit-producing fig tree where Jesus will come and he'll harvest you and take you home. And Jesus says in Revelation chapter 9 that the locusts are not allowed to hurt those with the seal of God. Revelation chapter 9, the Bible says, and here's where we close. Revelation chapter 9, the Bible says in verse 1, and when you're there, amen. And the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven under the earth. And to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. And he opened the bottomless pit, and there arose a smoke out of the pit, as the smoke of a great furnace. And the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. And there came out of the smoke, what? Locusts upon the earth. And unto them was given power, as the scorpions of the earth have power. I just have to put this plug in, friends. Forgive me for just giving this little plug. Does anyone know why the Lord tells you that the locusts also are like scorpions? Does anyone know what a scorpion does? It's the only animal, I'll just say it's an insect, but it's the only critter, it's the only creature in the animal kingdom that does this. Only one. Does anyone know what it does? Yes, Candace? It commits suicide. You know that? Google it. YouTube it. Put locust commit suicide. It'll all pop up. The locust is the only creature in the animal kingdom that commits suicide. Excuse me, what did I say? Locust, thank you. Scorpion, Freudian slip. The scorpion is the only creature in the animal kingdom that commits suicide. So why did God liken the Arabic Muslims to a scorpion? Because they commit suicide. And yet the Bible says in verse 3, and there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth, and unto them was given power, as the scorpions of the earth have power. I'd love to go into this more, but I won't. I'm going to restrain myself. And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any what? Any tree, but only those men which what? Have not the seal of God in their foreheads. So when the locusts are loose in the land and people begin dying by the thousands around us, friends, you have to notice that the locusts are not allowed to touch those with the seal of God who are trees that have fruit. Are you all with me, friends? And so as I close, our final scripture is Luke 21. Let's go back to the beginning and let's close it in a full circle. As we finally read Luke 21, we'll close it out as we look at that sign. And now all the pieces of the puzzle go together. I really wish if I had more time, Revelation chapter 9 If you want to see where the scorpions have their power, it's in their tail. And if you read later on, it's in their tail. And prophetically speaking, Isaiah chapter 9 tells you what the tail is. It's the prophet that teaches lies. And so therefore, the Islamic people, the scorpions, the locusts, their power is in their tail. It's in their false prophet who teaches lies. It's in the Muhammadan Quran. I would get my head chopped off if I said that anywhere else. Lord have mercy. I'm being serious, brothers and sisters. I sometimes fear, man. I go overseas and somebody's going to watch one of my YouTube videos and be like, this is him. See me in an orange jumpsuit. God have mercy. That is a horrible way to go. Shoot me in the head or something. But not, I mean, don't cut my head off. I'm not kidding, brothers and sisters. Think about how horrible this is. You know that ISIS is doing this, right? Cutting people's heads off and crucifying people. And people say, oh, it's horrific. Brothers and sisters, all they're doing is following the teachings of the Quran. You know that, don't you? I'm talking about their fundamentalist Salafist Muslims, Sunnis. They're simply following the letter of the Quran and the Hadith, which are the teachings and examples of the Prophet Muhammad passed down by tradition. That's all they're doing. And they're actually justifying it. They're saying, look, we're not fanatics. We're Muslims. We're just following the teachings of the Quran. That's all we're trying to do. They do that to a T. The Quran also dictates that you have to be able to take care of your people with socialized medicine. So when you go over there where they're controlling cities, like Raqqa and other places, everybody's taken care of on a social welfare system. Everybody's, you know that, don't you? Everybody gets, that's why they have these oil revenue. So they're actually following the letter of the Quran. They kill apostates and they take care of their people. It's really interesting, kind of, I wouldn't want to live in this society. And did you know that not all Christians are killed over there? They're saying that all the Christians are being killed. They're not. Because Muslim, the strict Sunni Salafist Muslims follow the Quran and they have what's called a jizya tax. And the jizya tax, if you are a Jew or a Christian that promises not to proselytize and you follow the teachings of Abraham, you don't eat pork, you don't smoke cigarettes, you don't drink alcohol, and you have modesty with your women, then you get to pay a tax and you get to keep your property. That's very interesting, isn't it? Again, I wouldn't want to live there. But they're following the teachings of Muhammad. Now that kind of sounds interesting. That sounds like maybe the Lord prepared for a certain people to do evangelism to these people to teach them about Jesus Christ, that he's more than a prophet. Which people do you know who are Christians that are the people of the book that don't eat pork, don't drink alcohol, don't smoke cigarettes, and their women are supposed to cover themselves? And they keep the laws of their father Abraham, including the Sabbath. Let's close out in Luke 21. Luke 21, and we're done. Luke 21. Heavenly Father, I just want to pray that you please help us to take this seriously, because Lord, we're living in the last days, and you have prepared for thousands of years this great controversy. You prepared a people in the last days to have the seal of God, to produce fruit, and even to evangelize these people. Lord, we need to get the third angel's message out to the world. We need to get the work done because it's almost over. Please be with us as we close with the scripture in Jesus' name. Amen. Luke 21, our closing text. Verse 27. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. When these things begin to come to pass, and look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. And he spake to them a parable. Behold, the fig tree and all the trees, when they now shoot forth, ye see and know of your own selves that summer is now nigh at hand. And so likewise ye, when ye see these things, brothers and sisters, come to pass, when ye see the grasshoppers in the land, when you see Islam and Bible prophecy, when you see the children of the East, when you see the fig tree shooting forth and bringing forth the fruits of righteousness, you know that we're in the time of the king's mowings, the latter harvest. When you see these things come to pass, know ye that the kingdom of God is nigh at hand. Verily, I say unto you, this generation shall not pass away until all be fulfilled. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. And take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and cares of this life, And so that day come upon you unawares, for as a snare shall it come on all them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. Watch ye therefore, and pray always, that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man. Brothers and sisters, the clock is about to strike midnight. We're in the final generation, and according to the word of the Lord, you've been at Adventist for 5 years, 10 years, 15, 20, 30, 40 years. But friends, the game is up. This generation will not pass away until we see Jesus Christ coming. Let's get ready. Let us pray. Your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed, and I want to make an appeal tonight. If the Holy Spirit has convicted your heart and you wish to cry out to the Lord and say, Lord, I need to be born again and converted. I want the fruits of righteousness in my life. I need to be ready for Jesus to come. I want to make an appeal for you to come forward and kneel at the front as a special altar call to say, Lord, I am not ready. I've heard these things year after year in my Adventist experience, but Lord, you have been speaking to me tonight that this generation shall not pass away. And Lord, I'm not ready. And Lord, I want to be ready. I need help in my life. Your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed. We're coming and pressing forward to kneel in the front. We're not being proud or arrogant. We're saying, Lord Jesus, I'm coming because I need help. Come to the front and pray. Our Lord Jesus has told us to beware, to take heed, lest at any time surfeiting, drunkenness, and even cares of this worldly life, this earthly life, would cause us to become so distracted that we would forget the weightier matters of the law, justice, mercy, faith, that Christ is calling us to have a born-again experience. We must be born of the Spirit and of the water. Without being born again, my brother, my sister, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. Have you been born again? Have you accepted Christ as your personal Savior? The Apostle Paul says, prove yourselves to know whether you're in the faith. Our Heavenly Father is a kind and merciful Father. He's not willing that any should perish, but that all come to repentance. And our Lord Jesus is a patient husbandman waiting for the early and latter rain to produce the fruit in our life that would show and prove to the world that we are Christians, not just in name, but in heart, mind, and soul. And oh, my Father in heaven, I come to thee personally in Jesus' name. I come to thee, O God of heaven, with my brothers and sisters in Christ kneeling with me as well. I come not in my pride and self-sufficiency. I come as a sinner in need of a Savior, asking that the Lord Jesus would come into my life, into my personal experience, and take away my heart of stone, and to give me a heart of flesh. And I pray the same things for my brothers and sisters in Christ here, that they would have the experience that old things would pass away, and behold, all things would become new. That the things that they once loved to do, they would now hate. The things that they once hated to do, they would now love. That they would become new creatures in Jesus Christ. For you have made him who knew no sin to become sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Jesus Christ, the wisdom and power and righteousness of God. We want him to be formed within the hope of glory. We want to be born again, Lord. And we want to have the conversion experience that would enter into every facet of our life, the way that we talk, the way that we think, the way that we feel, the way that we treat others, our actions. And I pray that you would, as Isaiah said, you would cause the groves and images in our lives to be beaten asunder. And that this would be the fruit to take away all our sin. Lord Jesus, you're coming before we think. You have given us a sign so that we can be prepared. But Lord, we're forgetful children. It's so easy to make a covenant with Christ and then get up off our knees and do the same exact thing. And so I beg you, Lord, for a power outside of ourselves. And for the Spirit of the living God to come in and dwell us, to shape us and mold us into your divine image. May we do our cooperative part by placing ourselves by faith, by choice, in the channel of blessing, and to pray and read the scriptures. But Lord, we pray that the scriptures, as we do that, that we would be born again, not by corruptible seed, but by incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. That word which spoke the worlds into existence, that we would believe that word would also speak light into the darkness of our souls. That your word will not come back void, but it would produce the fruit that you desire. And we pray that it would be naturally manifest in our lives to your honor and glory. Lord Jesus, we yield to you and we choose Christ and we choose to act by faith upon the living word of God that will do its work in us. And Lord, I just want to pray for my brothers and sisters that you'll be with them. Whatever sins are besetting them, please give them victory and strength. Give them grace. Give them power. Breathe into them spiritual life that these bones may live. Oh, Father in heaven, help us and prepare us for the terrors that will come upon this nation and world. May we not be scared during that day, but be able to look up with faith and tell our neighbors and friends and say, this is what the word of the Lord has said would happen. And you also must be ready because Jesus is coming. When people begin to wonder what's taking place around us, we can be able with confidence to say, yes, this is in Bible prophecy and it will get worse. Please get ready to meet Jesus Christ. Amen. We don't want to have blood upon our souls where they'll say, you knew. Why didn't you tell us? Lord, help us to be faithful watchmen. So, Father, bless this church. Be with your people. And I pray, Lord, you thank you so much for giving us a sign that's so clear. And now that we see it, I beg you, Lord, please help us to take advantage of that rain. The Bible says in Hosea 6 that he, Christ, will come to us as the rain. And so we want Jesus to come into our lives. Bless your people. And I pray that you would please seal a living experience in their lives that would continue to go forward and not backward. And that when you come the second time, Lord, you would be able to reap the precious fruit from the earth. Bless your people, Lord, and may your face shine upon them by turning us away from our iniquity. Thank you so much for this time. We make this covenant with thee by thy grace, and we claim your promises that he which has begun a good work in us will perform it and complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. Faithful is he that calleth you who will also do it. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Amen.